Well, hello and welcome back to Module 2. Hopefully you enjoyed the second part of Module 2, which was all about search, improving search and search engines. We're now moving on to the third part of Module 2, which is about content and copyright. And the first thing that we're going to have a little look at is we're going to be having a look at the reliability of digital content. I think what we'll do is we'll start off with a little story. I don't know if you've seen this picture before. This is probably one of the first examples of online email spam. I was sent this picture probably 100 times as a previous geography teacher, and it was associated always with this message: National Geographic Photograph of the Year. And you think you're having a bad day at work. Although this looks like a picture taken from a Hollywood movie, it is in fact a real photo taken near the South African coast during a military exercise by the British Navy. It's been nominated by National Geographic as Photo of the Year. Of course, the interesting thing about this photograph, it was a complete fake, but lots and lots of people believed it. It started off probably just as an idea of two pictures, a helicopter and a shark, a little bit of Photoshop, and then the person brought both of the pictures together as one. Now the interesting thing, of course, is that it's very, very difficult to see whether it's a fake or not, but there are a number of clues that gave it away. And the clue themselves are in the email. So for example, it's not a British helicopter, it's an American helicopter. It's not in South Africa because you can clearly see the Golden Gate Bridge in the USA behind it, although I am led to believe it is in fact a South African shark. And the interesting thing about this, of course, is that so many people believed it. In the end, it led to National Geographic putting a blog post up on their website saying that it was a hoax, and that then dramatically reduced the amount of calls they had for people looking for a copy of the photograph. An interesting story there in digital literacy, and an interesting story in credibility, and an important message that we must send our students is that it's not just digital content, written content, but it's all types of content they need to look at. So the important thing here is to understand that accessing the credibility of online sources is no different to traditional sources. In fact, in some ways, it's probably easier because there are more digital clues. Our challenge as educators is to teach our students what these digital clues are so that they can become detectives and they can become investigators. So here's a few tips and helpful hints that might help you a little bit on the way. First thing that we need to reinforce to students is they shouldn't believe everything that they read. Just like a traditional source, any digital source, we must always be critical towards and think about where that actual information came from in the first place. Let's have a think about websites now, for example. What can the URL of a website tell us? First of all, we can have a quick look to see if it's someone's personal page. Normally, if it's somebody's personal page, there's a little wavy line which tells you it's a personal page. It also has words like users, members, or people, which is included in it. Remember, if it's a personal page, it's likely to be biased towards that particular person. Another thing to look for is who published the page, and does the publisher of the site make sense? Normally, we find the publisher of the page between the HTTP and the first forward slash. For example, ed.ac.uk shows that comes from Edinburgh University, because it's an academic resource. Arguably, that might be more real and more reliable than somewhere that's not an academic resource. Domain reliability then. I've started to talk about that already. EDU or AC indicates a college or university. Org is normally an organisation. Gov is normally a government entity, and com is normally a commercial enterprise. Again, the type of domain can sometimes help us with the reliability of the content. We could also have a quick look around the page and look for other clues. What other clues can we see? This appears at the bottom of Microsoft's website. What are the author's credentials on the subject? What was the date it was last updated? What about the date on other pages of the sites? What else might bring the page credibility? Like privacy and cookies, terms of use, trademarks. What about the actual person that's published the work, their philosophy, their background, a biography? And is there a way that you can contact the owner of the site if you need to ask them more questions? All of these things are digital clues that we need to highlight to our students. What about the quality of the information? Are the sources documented as footnotes or links? Are there any links to other resources on the topic? Are the links well chosen? Do they work or are they out of date? Do the links represent other viewpoints? Or does the website itself indicate some sort of bias? Again, it's a massive amount of information that we need to teach our students to be online detectives. What's the purpose of the website? Is it to inform, to give facts, to share data? Are they trying to explain, persuade us? Are they just sharing information? Perhaps they're trying to sell us something or disclose something which maybe they shouldn't be disclosing. Ask your students the question, what are the purpose of the website? And see if they can take things from there. One of the most famous websites in the world is, of course, Wikipedia. And in one of the videos later on in the series, we're going to be having a quick look to see whether we think it's reliable or not. If you're interested in investigating reliability, then I suggest that you search for the Pacific Northwest tree octopus, because I heard that it might be nearing extinction. And it'd be an interesting website for your students to investigate to see whether they think it's reliable or not. Lots and lots of things to think about there. What sort of digital skills do you teach your students to become online detectives? And how do we convince them that digital content is not always reliable? They really need to be critical of everything that they see, listen to, and read online. See you in the next video.